Bristol Community College, Mathematics with Dan Avedikian, Math 119, Fundamental Statistics, Section 6.1, Problem 6. This is Section 6.1, Problem number 6. It says, consider the probability distribution shown below, and we have a probability distribution here. The first question is, Part A, is it a valid probability distribution? And like the others before, the answer, of course, is going to be yes, because if it wasn't valid, you couldn't answer the other parts that follow it. So why is it valid? Well, you have to see if all three of the requirements for probability distribution are satisfied, and it turns out they are. The first requirement is, every value in the first column is a number. Well, that's okay. The second requirement is, every value in the second column is a number that's between 0 and 1. That's okay too. And the third requirement is that the total of this second column adds up to 1. So 0.2 plus 0.3 is 0.5, 0.5 plus 0.4 is 0.9, and then 0.9 plus 0.1 is 1.0, which is 1. So the answer is yes. Yes, it is valid. All three of those requirements check out. So the answer to A, yes, this is valid. B, draw the histogram. So, see if I can fit the histogram right underneath here. So the histogram, again, they're looking for a bar graph with some specific rules, like the bars have to be vertical, they have to touch. So the probabilities are going to determine the heights of the bars. I only have one place after the decimal. Biggest probability is 0.4. So I just go 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4 is enough. I have room, I'll put in a 0.5. It doesn't cost me anything. I don't really need it, though. So, I've got my number scale label going up the left side. The first bar has a probability of 0.2, so it will have a height of 0.2. So here's 0.2, put a bar in, vertical of course. The number from the first column goes right under the center of that bar. The next bar will go to a height of 0.3, because it has a probability of 0.3, so 0.3. My graph, I go to that height. The bar, of course, touches the previous bar. The number under the center of that bar is the number from the first column, which is 20. The next bar has the biggest height, which is 0.4, because that's its probability. So 0.4, again, I'm going to make them touch. The number from the first column is 30, so that goes right under the center of the bar. And the last bar just has a height of 0.1, because its probability is 0.1. 0.1, go to that height. Keep the bars touching. The number from the first column, which is 40, goes under the center of that bar. So that's B. Draw the histogram. There it is. C. Find the mean. In other words, the average value if you conduct this experiment, whatever it is, millions of times, and you find the average of the millions of results. So to find that answer, what you want to do is multiply every value in the first column times its probability, take those answers that you get and add them together. So in the top row, the number in the first column times its probability will be 10 times 0.2, which is just 2 when you multiply that out. The next row, the number from the first column is 20 times its probability is 0.3. If you multiply 20 times 0.3, you'll get 6. The next row down, the number from the first column is 30 times its probability is 0.4. So if you multiply that out, you get 12. And finally, the last row, the number from the first column is 40 times its probability is 0.1. If you multiply 40 times 0.1, you'll just get 4. Again, you could do these on a calculator. These are easy enough for me. I can do them without the calculator, but by all means, you can do the calculator if you like. And now to find the mean or expected value, some books call, you're going to add these numbers together. 2 plus 6 is 8, 8 plus 12 is 20, 20 plus 4 more is 24. So that's the mean for this probability distribution, 24. And part D, find the variance. So to find the variance, and again, this is a measure of how spread out the results of your experiment are from one trial to the next, you have to fill in that chart and get a total of the last column. So the chart that we will fill in, we will have a column for x, a column for x minus the mean, and the symbol for the mean is mu. And then we will have x minus mu in parentheses to the second power, that's going to be the next column. And the last column is x minus mu in parentheses to the second power times probability of x. And that's what we have to fill in. Let me just make some rows. So the values for x are the values for x that are given in the question, 10, 20, 30, 40. So in the x column, I put 10, 20, 30, 40. That's easy enough. And now, the next column, x minus mu. So the value of x in the row that you're in minus mu, the answer for the mean, which in this problem is 24. So in the top row, x is 10 minus mu is 24. 10 minus 24 is negative 14. In the next row, x minus mu, now x is 20 in this row, minus mu is still 24. 20 minus 24 is negative 4. And the next row down, x is 30 minus mu, again mu is still 24. 30 minus 24 is positive 6. And in the bottom row, x is now 40 minus mu, still 24. 40 minus 24 is positive 16. So now as we go to the next column, you're going to take the answers that we got for x minus mu and raise them to the second power. So in the top row, the answer for x minus mu was negative 14. So we'll do negative 14 second power. Negative 14 times negative 14 is positive 196. Again, notice the negatives cancel. The second row, the answer for x minus mu was minus 4, so we'll raise minus 4 to the second power. And that'll be minus 4 times minus 4, which is positive 16. And now in the third row, the answer for x minus mu was 6, so we'll do 6 to the second power, which will be 6 times 6, which gives us an answer of 36. And finally, the bottom row, the answer for x minus mu was 16, so we'll do 16 second power, which is 16 times 16, which is positive 256. Now, the next column, we're going to take the x minus mu second power answers that we got and multiply them times the probability for x, which I'm going to get from the original question. So the top row, the x minus mu second power was 196. Times probability of x. So on the top row, probability of x is 0.2. So 196 times 0.2 is 39.2. Now the second row, the x minus mu second power is 16. And I'll multiply that times the probability from the second row. So coming over here is 0.3. So 16 times 3 is 48, but it'll wind up being 4.8 because of the decimal. And now the next row, the x minus mu answer is 36 times probability of x. So probability of x in this third row is 0.4. So 36 times 0.4 is 14.4. And finally, in the bottom row, the answer for x minus mu second power is 256. So I'll do 256 for the first set of parentheses. Times probability of x in the bottom row. Probability of x is 0.1. 256 times 0.1 is 25.6. So to finish the process of finding the variance, what I need to do is add these together. 39.2 and 4.8 match up pretty nicely. It makes 44. And 14.4 and 25.6 also matches up pretty nicely to 40 if you add them together. So I'm going to have 44 plus 40 is 84. I can actually add them without the calculator, which you totally don't have to do. I mean, you can just take the calculator. You can do it all with the calculator. You can add these numbers and get 84. I can actually see it without the calculator. So that's the answer for the variance. The variance is 84. And finally, part E, the standard deviation. The standard deviation is the square root of whatever the variance was, square root of 84. Now that I need a calculator for. I can estimate it a little bit. But to get an accurate answer, I do need the calculator. So square root of 84, the calculator says 9.165155139. It's a little bit more than, not quite, say 9.2. So pretty close. And that's it.